It's time to babble the fuck on. Live from the world-famous improv, it's Hollywood Babylon. With your hosts, Kevin Smith and Ralph Garman.
It's Friday night in Hollywood, so let's babble the fuck on. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman.
Hey!
It's post time.
Things are going to be off tonight. I had one of the worst days of my life. I'm in the middle of a massive fucking fight with my wife. All day long, I was like, I can't wait till 10 o'clock. I can't wait till 10 o'clock. Oh my God, Babble, save me. And so here I am. So if during the fucking show at any point, I start getting off track and I'm like, well, maybe that's her fucking problem. That's what it is.
Roger that. We'll bring it right back.
And apologies in advance. How is everyone this evening? You sold us out again.
Yes, thank you so much.
If you keep selling us out, you're going to keep encouraging us. We're going to keep doing this bad shit over and over again.
We'll never shut up. Everyone survived the rain okay? Did everyone get through the storm? You all survived? Fuck, right? Weather, huh? Who's with me? People are listening in other parts of the world saying, you fucking assholes. It rained for 8 minutes.
Who's Megan, who used to run my life. True. She sent a picture from Long Island where she lives now. She's like, this is my 5-foot fence. And you couldn't see it. It was a sea of snow.
Just snow.
I said, come back to reality. Come back to California.
There was a puddle in front of my house. A whole puddle.
Of?
Rain.
Oh.
For a change. Usually it's my vomit, but...
I thought it was like a line of Ralph fans outside your house. Like, there he is. Gah! Yeah.
No, I've got a guy who swabs that up every day.
You're fucking rich, man.
Oh, yeah. I got rich man problems.
It's like K-Rock money.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what it is. It's the high-paying world of radio.
Yeah.
Every time we start this show off, we like to talk to people who come particularly long distances or are celebrating special occasions with us this evening. We call this segment, appropriately, the Shoutouts.
It's a shout-out with Kevin and Ralph, so get your cock out. Yeah, yeah. Get your cock out.
Something that won't be happening to me later this evening.
Well...
Maybe never again. It was one of those fucking fights. Do you ever have one of those fights where you're like, I can't fucking ever conceive of even fucking you ever again? Like those fights, we were almost there.
Oh, my Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys have fucked through some bad fights. I'm surprised.
Really bad fights, yeah. Too. Nothing like fucking marriage shattering either. Just like fucking, you're fucking the guy who made Dusk. Shit like that, you know? Which I can't blame her. I'm like, yeah, I am, I guess.
You want to...
No,
cover
I'm
some
good,
ground
I'm good,
before
I'm
we
good.
Move on. If you need good. To purge, we're here for you, man. Good. We're here for you. You're I'm amongst good. Friends.
No, it's I'm totally. But as I was pretending to suck the dick, as right, I always do at this show,
sure.
And have a good time doing it. This week, it was just a little
takes
less
on
special.
A brand new meaning.
Yeah. Okay. Take me fucking away, dude. Take me to like useless news. What's going on in Hollywood?
Well, we got some shout-outs and stuff to get through first before we do that.
Oh. Shout out.
Are you familiar with the show at all? Yeah. The Hollywood Babylon program? We talk to some people first, and then we cover the news a little
fair
bit later
enough.
On in
all
the
right.
show.
I'm ready for that. That'll take my mind off it as well.
You know what'll take your mind off it? Talking to these newlyweds who are on their honeymoon. Just dawned on me now. Our first shout out. Robert and Katrina Rosales. Are you guys here? Robert and Katrina?
Where are you?
Over there. How you doing, newlyweds? How are you?
Congratulations. Congratulations. Don't listen to what I'm saying, even though you're fucking doomed. Congratulations.
Katrina writes, I'd love for you to give a shout out to my wonderful husband, Robert, who's a huge fan of you both. We're newlyweds who just got married in October. That's not newlyweds. How long are you going to milk this fucking newlywed thing? And we wanted this to be our final hurrah on the honeymoon experience.
Aww.
I love you, babe. Here's to many years of love. Is that for me or for him? Or I'm confused, Katrina. Well, that's nice, Katrina. And in a gift of the Magi kind of way. Yeah, I know it's an O. Henry reference. I apologize.
I was a little surprised. I was like, holy shit, man.
We got an email from Robert. A shout out to Katrina as well. Isn't that adorable?
Oh.
Robert writes, attending the show with my beautiful wife, Katrina. We got married in October, but just had our honeymoon earlier this month. Although she may not realize it, I'm considering this show as the tail end of our honeymoon and my last ditch effort to get at her tail end. Huh? Huh? So she's all, I love you, babe, forever, and you're all sphincter.
And guess what? 17 years later, you'll be fighting about it.
I smell a theme. If sexy Kev doesn't get me into the secret entrance to her bat cave, I don't know what will. Thanks for all the free funny, Robert. So sexy Kev, if you can put marital strife aside and try to talk Katrina into
it. I can, because fucking sex is sex. It's a bedrock of fucking marriage, so I can always put sex first. Give me the fucking music.
Okay.
Oh, Robert. Just fucking run. To Katrina's vagina. And be good and fucking just eat the shit out of it and fucking do everything you can for her. And then when she complains that you haven't done enough, keep doing more. Isn't that sexy? That's marriage. Welcome to it, fuckers.
Yeah. How does that get Robert in her ass?
Oh, give me the music.
Music.
Oh, Katrina, fucking, just let him do it. Jesus, you're married.
All right, okay. All right. Stephen Morgan from Ames, Iowa. Are you here, Stephen?
Yeah.
I thought he was going to fucking punch you, yeah?
I'm not with the IRS, Stephen. It's just a comedy show. You act like you got called up to the draft or something. Yeah, I'm here. What do you want? What the fuck's going on? Was that one poisoned or something? Don't just take a man's drink without giving him some information. Did someone loogie in it? What happened?
There was a puddle in it.
All right, Steven, are you here by yourself? Co-worker, okay.
What the fuck? He's like, I'm here with a co-worker. Is he a friend? Fuck no, he's a co-worker.
This shout-out is for you, Stephen. I introduced my co-worker, Stephen Morgan, to Babylon months ago, and the bastard has the audacity to make it to a live show before I was able to.
Aww.
We both live in Ames, Iowa. He had a business trip to L.A. this week, and we'll be attending the show. Stephen has made some great life changes in the past year, which includes divorcing his lifeless ex-wife.
We gotta hang out, man.
Things are looking up, Kev.
Yes.
And crossing the 100-pound mark in his weight loss. You've lost 100 pounds?
Who? You? Holy fuck.
Wow.
Well done, man.
You're a good-looking dude now. I mean, you probably were before.
Yeah, fuck you with the weight he was.
No, I'm just saying. You wouldn't look at him and say, well, there's a guy who lost 100 pounds. He just looks like a good-looking dude from Ames, Iowa.
We just got an insight into your mindset, which is like, thin people rule.
That's America's mindset. It's not just mine.
How'd you do it? Everyone wants to know. Whenever I lose weight, or people go, how'd you do it and shit? Now I want to know because I'm like, that's more than I lost. How'd you do it? Working out? Fuck
yeah,
that. How'd you really do it? What special food did you eat, man? It was peanut butter, right? That's awesome. Congratulations.
100 pounds. That's great.
That's fucking massive.
However, this email continues. Uh-oh. This is from Dan Sievers, by the way. You know Dan? He's the one who sent this out to you. However, his freeloading ex and her current boyfriend still live in Stephen's basement.
Dude, you may have lost 100 pounds, but you gained about 200 more, sounds like, in the basement.
Yeah. There's a lot of dead weight down in the basement.
Yeah, really.
If he's going to get back to the dating scene, he will most likely run into trouble with an ex still living in the basement. I think that's a fair assessment.
Totally, man.
He's a fan of the Expendables movies. So I thought maybe Sylvester Stallone could give me a little advice on life. Babylon, Dan Sievers.
Yo, Steven. You know,
There's one thing to be a nice guy and all, you know, your ex-wife say, yeah, you need a place to crash for a little while, but with the boyfriend, what's wrong with you? You're the balls, get your balls back. I ain't a tiger, Steven, I ain't a tiger. Unbelievable. You gotta be mentally irregular.
I was going to ask you for the name of your lawyer, but you got your fucking wife and her new boyfriend downstairs. Basement, yeah. I don't think it's working out, man.
That is an amicable divorce right
there.
Yeah,
holy shit. Yeah. That's friendly.
Jeremy and Katie.
We love each other.
Katie writes, my fiancé Jeremy is a fighter pilot in the
holy
Air Force.
Shit, I'll shut the fuck up.
You're going to get your ass kicked.
From the ground and the sky. Be driving home like, what a great show.
Fighter pilot.
A fighter pilot? Dude, that is so hot.
I know, it's fucking...
I got a little bit of a hard on.
She literally could have said pilot, but she fucking picked the
fighter
right modifier,
pilot.
Yeah. Because instantly I was like, TIE fighter pilot?
And I'm...
That's to make up for the lost
booze. Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know what's going on. So you're like, it's like Top Gun, like Goose and Maverick and shit? Fuck. The couple of things fighter pilots and you guys have in common. They're all super nerdy and have six senses of humor. See, I could have been a fighter pilot. Jeremy recently moved in with me and increased his commute by about an hour and a half. Holy shit.
Oh, he increased it by moving in with you.
You he has to commute for an hour and a half more because he lives with you now?
Because of you?
Yeah.
You must fuck well.
Why don't you just fly your jet back and forth from the house?
Is that possible? I hadn't thought of that. How long would that take? Like 3 minutes?
The shortest commute ever. Park it on the roof. So I suggest, and he livened up his commute by listening to the show. When he started singing More Margaritas the other day, I knew it was time to pop his HBO Live cherry.
No.
Can the Germans please welcome Jeremy to the show and let him know how much I appreciate him commuting back and forth to serve our country by day and service me by night.
Yeah. Oh.
Thanks, and babble the fuck on, Katie.
Guten Tag.
Yeah, guten Tag. Welcome into the show.
You are fucking Mitt the Red Baron.
Yeah, American bombers reminds me of Dusseldorf in the bad old days. When they would come over and bomb the Fatherland, but they're always forgiven.
You bastard.
But with his lady, and he turns off the light, and he uses the force, no targeting computer.
He's
just
real.
Goes in him just like, ang.
He is a real fighter pilot, not a Luke Skywalker.
No, none of that bullshit.
Yeah, so Luftwaffe was good, huh? They also flew fighters, the Luftwaffe.
I don't know that much history.
That was the German Air Force, the Luftwaffe, in the Second World War.
Ah, I see, I understand. You have to be smart to get this joke, I see.
First O. Henry, now Luftwaffe.
So many obscure references.
Talking myself right out of the show tonight. Anyway, guten Tag, and thanks for coming
guten
to the show
tag.
Tonight. Yes.
Welcome.
All right. I got to dumb it down.
That was sympathy applause. They're like, thank God it's over.
Yeah, that was adorable. Mike Seitzler, you hear me?
Holy fuck, he brought a fan club,
yeah.
Man.
I only named one of you, okay? Long-time listener, first-time traveler, all the way from Tampa, Florida. Fucking Florida. Here to pop my HBO cherry with my wife, Sammy, and HBO virgins, Abby, Alex, Cam, and Dan. Only my wife has heard the podcast, so could the most intelligent man on wheels, Stephen Hawking, let my good friends know what they're in for? And if possible, could you tell my friend back home, Kevin, who couldn't make the trip to go fuck himself? Your best friend, I'm guessing?
Hello, and welcome to Hollywood Babylon. I'm so glad that that cocksucker Kevin isn't here. Kevin, go fuck yourself. Stick a fist right up your black hole.
Not saying he's black. I don't know if he's black or not. I'm just saying. It's just an astrophysics reference. It's just... Shit, what if the guy's black? Now I'm really fucked.
Is he black?
Is he black? No, no, you're from Florida. You don't have any black friends. What was I thinking? Hell no, he ain't black! From Tampa, goddammit.
Did you, like, take the SATs this week or something? All your jokes are smart. What are you doing?
Took one of them Bradley Cooper pills.
I guess, man. Holy shit. No more of this fucking... It's all highfalutin. No more of this, you know what Al Pacino would say. It's fucking...
It's all school books this week. We also get emails from all around the world. Josh?
Ain't no drag.
Garmin's got an email.
Featuring Kevin's reactions.
This week we got a lot of pictures. People sending in inappropriate toys. That seems to be a thing now. We're collecting pictures of inappropriate toys.
Do that many on the marketplace?
So many on the marketplace. People see them and think of us, which is cool. And they take a picture and they send it in, like Chris V from Jacksonville, Florida. Here's one of your brothers here.
Did you literally raise the roof for that?
Raise the roof for Jacksonville?
On one hand, she's got wine in one hand, a one-handed casual like, Florida!
Spring break, bitches!
The Wang State.
She's got a tramp stamp of Florida. Looks like an arrow pointing to her ass. Chris from Jacksonville writes, recently took my daughter to our zoo, and when we visited the gift shop, I noticed these toys. I couldn't help but think, in Florida, Superman blows you. So it's a Superman toy. Can we take a look at this? Can we dim the lights a little bit? Yeah. Apparently his cock is so powerful, it will cool you off in the summertime. If I was Superman, I would spin my cock around and fan people with it. That'd be awesome.
It's a fucking hazard, man. Turn that thing on somebody. Give Lois something to write about.
This next listener wrote in. He didn't leave his name, so I'm just going to call him by his email address, which is Lunch Money. Lunch Money writes in, just found this. I'm assuming it's a real toy or it's a Bronies fleshlight. Are you guys familiar with the Bronies, the My Little Pony guys who love those? This is an actual toy that Lunch Money found on the store shelf, and he took a picture of it for us. Yeah. I don't know why this My Little Pony has the rear orifice.
What is that about? It's right next to her cutie mark. Like her own tramp stamp.
That's right, and that's where you you make your deposit. I guess it's a bank.
Sperm bank.
And lastly, Brian Ochoa wrote this one, sent this in, thought you might like this for Hollywood Babylon. He found this on a store shelf.
What the fuck?
It's apparently a bear that you put a ping pong ball in his mouth and you squeeze his tummy and it pops out. But the way it's packaged, looks like ball gag bear.
Bring out the gimp.
So that seems like it's appropriate for children.
We need a theme song for that. We're going to have more pictures of dirty toys. And also, for the record, we will accept pictures of toys blowing each other and shit. They don't have to look like fucking naturally dirty. You can make them look dirty.
Yeah,
we'll probably
sure,
show them here on the show.
Dirtier the better.
Yeah.
Steven Selig writes in from sunny Northern California. I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but this week marks the 30th anniversary of the recording of We Are the World to raise money and awareness for USA for Africa.
Wow.
So I thought it might be time for Arnold Schwarzenegger to call on some of his closest friends and do another rendition of the 1985 classic We Are the World. He's asking Arnold to sing We Are the World and bring some friends along to also pitch in sort of an all-star, if you will.
The fuck out of here.
Yeah, so.
That's actually a genius idea,
man. It
is kind
of cool. I said, yeah, that sounds like fun.
I've been sitting here for nearly 200 episodes. I was never like, why don't you sing along with yourself?
So we're going to try this. It doesn't look good. This is We Are the World. Y'all know We Are the World, right? This is
We Are the World, as done by Al Pacino. Well, you'll find out who's going to sing along. But it's Arnold Schwarzenegger and his showbiz friends. Can we get a little bed for this, Josh?
Check your ego at the door, man. Oh, there comes a time when we heed a certain call, when the world must come together as one.
There are people dying,
and it's time to lend a hand
to life, the greatest gift of all.
We can't go on pretending day by day
that someone somewhere will soon make a change.
We are all part of the great family.
And the truth, you know, love is all we need.
We are the world. We are the children.
We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's not give it.
Yeah, the choice we're making, and we're saving our own lives. It's true, we make a better day, just you and me.
There you go, We Are the World, Arnold and Friends.
That was fucking impressive, man. Every one of those impressions could have been recorded fucking 30 years ago.
That's true. Every week we say goodbye to some people in show business who left behind bodies of work and left us all too soon. They are
the Tinseltown Stiffs.
And now another edition of
Tinseltown Stiffs.
They will be missed.
Some of them. It's a bad batch this week. It's not anybody really famous.
But that's a good thing when it's a bad batch. Means like nobody really died.
Well, these people did. Just because they're enough. Not as famous as some of the other people we talk about.
Fair enough.
So it's nice to have one biggie a week, you know?
Keep fucking wishing for that, man.
It's not going to be me. I'm not a biggie.
Yeah, you are, man. You're huge.
Yeah.
Ralph fucking Garman.
That's right. I forgot. You're very kind and very much in the minority. Songwriter and poet Rod McEwen passed away this week. See, you're all, who?
I know.
But in the
is.
60s and 70s, this guy was the bomb. He was like the poet laureate of show business. He made a ton of money with spoken word records and singing horribly and writing songs that were just sappy and sentimental. 73 years old, he passed away this week. He had a bunch of albums. Sinatra, in 1969, Frank Sinatra recorded an album of all of the songs that he had written. Only Rod McEwen songs, an entire album. He was also known for writing a song called Seasons in the Sun, which then was recorded by a guy named Terry Jacks in 1974. It was a huge hit for him.
Depressing song.
Very depressing, about dying and saying goodbye to your friends and stuff and everything. Yeah.
It is. I remember being a kid and trying to like fucking groove out to that song, and I realized this is a funeral dirge. Somebody's fucking dead in this song.
We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun. Now you're dead. I think that's how it went. Anyway,
like
now he's
your
dead.
Your version is so fucking metal, man. Now you're dead, now you're dead, now you're motherfucking dead.
And Rod McEwen is indeed motherfucking dead this week.
Rod McEwen also recorded one of my favorite songs, A Boy Named Charlie Brown.
That's right, he did a couple songs
for that
cartoon.
In the cartoon, he did A Boy Named Charlie Brown. It's a very melancholy song. But yeah, he was huge.
He was a downer, quite frankly.
Yeah. Kind of was.
Joe Franklin, if you grew up in the East Coast.
He fucking died? She goes, yes.
She's confirming it, yes. You have confirmation.
Holy fuck.
Joe Franklin is
dead. That's an East Coast thing.
If you grew up in the East Coast in Jersey or New York or in that region, Joe Franklin was an icon on television. He had a talk show from, let me get the dates right, from 1950 to 1993. For 43 years, the guy had a talk show in local television in New York City. On WOR there, the superstation. He has the record in the Guinness Book of World Records for the longest running talk show, 43 years. Mm. He claims to have interviewed over 300,000 guests during that period. Because he would talk to four or five people a show. And it was always
like his podiatrist, and then and then like Bob Hope. It was a weird batch.
Yeah.
He always said himself, he talked to the greats, the near greats, the ingrates, the has-beens, and the never were's. And he would talk to literally almost anybody. If you pitched yourself, he would answer his own phone. You could say, I want to promote my yard sale, and he would have you on. I mean, he needed content. But then you would have, like, Bing Crosby would come by, or one of these big stars. I remember watching an episode back in the day of Spinal Tap. It was Michael McKean and Christopher Guest and Harry Shearer. They went on and pitched themselves as Spinal Tap, and Franklin had no idea that they weren't Spinal Tap. And he treated the interview like he was really talking to this band from England that apparently he pretended like he knew who they were, and it was very entertaining.
That's fucking tremendous.
But if you grew up in the New York, Jersey area, you loved Joe Franklin.
Or didn't, because if you were a kid and that show came on, it meant there were no cartoons on.
Because it was an afternoon show, right?
Oh, Christ, yes. And it was when I was a child, it was like, we're watching adults talk. Why? Like, you just wanted to see cartoons. But the older I got, I would kick back and watch that show. And it had that old-timey opening theme music. Like Nickelodeon kind of thing.
Yeah.
But it was very, like, he did have panels that were not all famous people.
No.
It was like sometimes, like, this dude makes bagels. This dude has been in 96 movies. This dude I was married to at one point. Like, yeah. Very disparate, man.
Very eclectic.
And he was obviously, it was a passion. He didn't get paid a lot. It's not like he did it for 43 years and he was a fucking billionaire.
This was like cable access.
Cable access television.
He would occasionally have a big get. It's all over the internet. If you go on YouTube, you can find a bunch of videos featuring Joe Franklin.
Wow, that's so fucking.
This
sad.
Was one of my favorites. The Ramones stopping by Joe Franklin. And Joe, God love him. He liked people, but he didn't really get a lot of stuff. He had no idea that the Ramones weren't really brothers. That was my favorite part of the whole interview while he was talking to the Ramones. Here's a little bit of Joe Franklin speaking with the Ramones.
Hey, there's no doubt about it.
Joey and?
Marky.
Hiya.
Hi.
Boy, what
Hello.
A pleasure.
How are
it's good
you?
To be here.
Have you ever seen our show on TV, The Real Truth, Joey?
Oh, yeah. I've seen you since I was about five, I would think.
Really?
Yeah, I used to watch Memory Lane.
That's right.
Yep. My mom used to turn around and say, Mom, I want to watch the show.
Well, your mom always had good taste in programs.
She has taste.
And in sons, right?
Right.
Mark? Yeah, your mom with all of the sons. All Mrs. Ramone had all the sons, yeah.
Billy Crystal used to do them on Saturday Night Live for a couple seasons as well. Yeah. Wow, that's a massive part of our childhood.
88 now. Years old, he passed away this
Huge
week.
Huge bucket of wind, man. This motherfucker, like, aced life, crushed it, and fucking walked out, dropped the mic at 88. Good for him, man.
Yeah.
Awesome life. But he was one of those people that you were like, I'm going to die before Joe Franklin will.
Yeah.
But apparently that's not the case.
It's not at all. And this guy died a couple weeks ago. I just found out about it, but I wanted to include him because I'm a huge fan of British invasion music from the 60s. I love all those British bands. And this guy, Trevor Ward Davies, was the bass player in a... it wasn't a big band here in the States, but around the world, they had a ton of hits in the 60s. A band called Davy D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick, and Titch. That was their name. That was the name of the band. Davy D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick, and Titch. I think maybe that's why they never caught on in the United States. It was the shittiest name for a band at any time in the 60s. Because, you know, people were the Monkees, the Beatles, the Turtles, the Animals. Davy D, Dozy, Mickey, Beaky, Titch. Fuck! I can't even get it out.
If you're going to use that many names, just call yourself the phone book.
That's right. Anyway, they were a huge band in England, in Australia, in New Zealand, in Canada. A ton of top 10 hits, not so much in the States, but I was a big fan, and he was the bass player. Passed away at 70 on January the 13th. And the reason I bring them up also is you may know one of their songs called Hold Tight, because Quentin Tarantino
Death
used
Proof.
It in Death
That's
Proof.
That's where I thought I knew the name from.
Hold Tight is the song that the girls are listening to in the car
when, they get it.
When spoilers, Kurt Russell... interrupts their day. Here's a little footage of Davy D, Dozy, Beaky, Mick, and Titch as they play Hold Tight.
Never fall. Each time you call, hold tight.
God, if I could travel in time, I would go back to that era. It looks like so much fun.
Why, because of the hair?
Well, more than just the hair. I want to be one of those guys in one of those bands, just doing this, being happy.
You can literally do that now and be happy.
I know, but it looks happier than black and white for some reason.
It was so dramatic, like he walked up and then just turned to time for the lyric.
I know, so cool. Anyway, he's dead. So I guess it's not that cool to be that part of the time.
Yeah.
Every week, we like to take a look at some A-list actors who turn in less than A-list performances, but sometimes bad acting can go all the way around and become, oh, someone's a fan of this bit. It can go all the way around and become exquisite acting.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Welcome to the world of exquisite acting with Ralph Garman and Kevin Smith.
This week's exquisite acting comes from Kathy in Sydney, Australia.
Whoa.
Are you here? What's that? You're from Australia. Great.
But you didn't write this, though.
You're not Kathy, are you?
Are you with the dude who's shielding himself from you right now? You're from Sydney? From Perth. I've been there. Good day. Right on, man. Welcome to Los Angeles. Put a dick in your mouth and let us do our fucking show, would you?
Sorry, he had a fight with his wife earlier. It's not your fault. He's just a little tense.
Yeah, I wasn't yelling at you. I was yelling at someone else right there.
Yeah. Usually he's a teddy bear. Usually he's very
totally.
Nice.
Totally. Welcome. Yeah. Welcome to Los Angeles. Right. Diplomatic immunity.
Wrong country. Wrong country. Kath writes, Kerry Russell's been doing some excellent work of late in FX's The Americans. You guys watching The Americans? Kerry Russell?
Yeah.
Great series.
Good
and
show.
She was great in Felicity, too. But she's not so great in what we're about to show you. Kath writes, she has really honed her reaction to a dead body look since the 1996 TV movie The Babysitter's Seduction. I don't know if you guys ever saw this classic 90s TV movie, but she plays a teenage babysitter who is seduced by the older husband that of the couple that she babysits for, played now in a very creepy way by Stephen Collins. He plays the...
Oh, shit.
Takes on a whole new meaning now
really.
When you watch it. But in this film, Carrie Russell, as the teenage babysitter, comes across the wife of the family that she babysits for, finds her dead, murdered in the kitchen. And her reaction is can only be called exquisite acting. Let's take a look.
It's like she smelled a fart.
Right.
Oh, this dead body farted.
The wife died. She didn't pass gas, Carrie. Dead people stink. How about a fucking scream? She's dead.
She was holding on to that for the Felicity years.
She was. She was saving on to that. Every week, we also like to look at some TV and motion pictures that hundreds of pairs of eyes see before it reaches you, the paying audience. However, invariably, we find things that just slip through the cracks, stuff that somebody should have caught but didn't, and we call that stuff shit that should not be.
And now for shit we should not see. Here's some shit that should not be.
This week's shit that should not be is from the Bruce Willis movie 16 Blocks. I thought you would enjoy taking a shot at a Bruce Willis film.
Not at all. Go ahead.
All right.
This day just keeps getting better.
Richard Donner directed from 2006.
It's actually a good movie. Have you ever seen it?
It is a pretty good
movie.
It's
really good. I mean,
very,
Richard Donner is a fantastic director, but this is a pretty compelling fucking flick.
Bruce Willis, Mos Def, David Morse, all-star in the film. Nick in Virginia sent this in. He was watching 16 Blocks the other night, and it's one of those cases where an extra just fucks things up for everybody. At one point in the film, Bruce Willis and Mos Def are running away from some bad cops, and they get on a city bus, and they're traveling across the city, and Bruce Willis tells the driver, don't stop for anything, just keep going. And Mos Def is trying to calm down the passengers who see Bruce Willis's gun. They don't know he's a cop. They're very upset.
And so someone apparently told the extras, someone raised their hand and said, Mr. Director, what do we do? I'm an extra. I don't know what I should do in this scene. And he said, well, just pretend you're making a phone call. The girl who asked that question should have realized she probably would need a cell phone to pretend she's making a phone call.
Oh, no.
But you got to enjoy your space work in this scene from 16 blocks. Please watch The Shit That Should Not Be.
Just keep driving.
What are you doing?
I'm a cop. Lock the back door.
He's got a gun!
Loose mouse.
Tell him to hang on to something, Eddie!
Hang on! Don't worry, kid. He's a police officer.
Yeah. Here, watch her on this side. Right there, yeah. No shit, she is talking into her finger and her thumb like she's making a phone call. Are you fucking kidding me with this? Why did you pretend to be drinking? Or smoking?
And then she's like, I gotta get out of here.
I'm in a plastic box inside the bus.
Hey, what am I doing now? That is amazing, man. She looks like she's going out the window to somebody, like, call me.
Yeah, I'm a hostage. Can you call?
Put a plastic baby in those hands.
Yes, that's right. Every week, of course, the reason we're here is to take a look at all the entertainment news for the week and something we call the HBO headlines. This is my favorite one of the week, so I thought we'd kick it off with this story. Gwyneth Paltrow, I don't know if any of you ladies follow the Goop website. I've seen some Goop websites, but it's not the same kind of website that I think Gwyneth Paltrow is talking about. But she's got a lifestyle website called Goop.com.
Yes. Your Goop website is the puddle outside
your
house.
That's right, yes. And Gwyneth will give you all the tips on how to live your life better the way Gwyneth Paltrow does. This week, she is urging her followers to steam their vaginas. Gwyneth Paltrow steams her vagina on a regular basis. She goes to a spa that gives something called the Mugwort V-Steam, which sounds like something from Harry Potter, doesn't it?
Steamicus.
Which she claims cleanses her vagina and uterus and provides an energetic release.
Meaning it makes you come?
I don't know.
That's what an energetic release is.
Let me explain in her words what it's like. The real golden ticket here is the Mugwort V-Steam. Ooh, sounds like Willy Wonka. You get your vagina steamed. Good day, madam. You smell fizzy lifting drinks. And now I'm going to steam your vagina.
If you want to view paradise. There's no way of knowing why your vagina's flowing.
The schnozberries taste like schnozberries.
The real golden ticket here is the Mugwort V-Steam. You sit on what is essentially a mini throne. Oh, I'm sure it is. I'm sure it's a fucking throne. Queen for a day. You get a combination of infrared light and mugwort steam. It cleanses your uterus.
It's got to shoot up at you, yeah.
This sounds bad.
When do you come? That's what I want to know.
Well, she continues. It's an energetic release, not just a steam douche.
Oh, she ruined all the sexy, man. I was digging it until fucking steam douche. You want to go do a steam douche?
I like steam clams, but that's not my thing.
Douche.
It balances your female hormone levels. If you're in L.A., you have to do it, she writes.
Why? Because they only do it here?
Apparently, it's only available at the Tikkun Spa in Santa Monica. There are hipsters fucking right. Five different V-Steams are available.
Did you hear everyone got quiet? Because we're all like, that's near us.
Yeah.
And the Florida people were like one hand in the air like,
For a change, it's not Florida.
We don't sit on pussy cleaners.
There are five different V-Steams available. One is the signature. You know, just the basic. The basic steamed clam.
You get in, get out, get a little steam, and off you go. Steamed clam.
One is the slimming, which apparently makes you lose weight.
Right there?
Yep. The infertility, it helps you get pregnant, apparently, this one. And the postpartum, after you've had a baby, this is good for you.
Hmm.
Now, if you're a fella, don't feel left out. Because they offer the V-steam for the ladies, but for the gentlemen, there's the A-steam. That's right. They'll steam your anus.
Oh, I was like, what's the A? But wait a second. So there's a V-steam for the vagina?
Right.
And they're like, well, the equal and opposite must be an A-steam for the asshole. What about the fucking D-steam, man?
Well, if you're eager to have your dick steamed, I'm sure that someone could accommodate you at the Tikkun Spa for a couple extra bucks.
Where is that again?
Santa Monica. Santa Monica.
I'm going to look into that.
I love the list of things. It says medicinal properties of the V-steam. It's got a long list of things it says it does for you. Aids in regular menstrual cycles. Helps fight infections. Kills intestinal worms. Stimulates production of milk. Well, I don't want that. And then at the bottom it says, the above statement has not been evaluated by the FDA. Because, you know, science. This was a good story this week. You guys know Sam Smith's Stay With Me, that song we've all heard a thousand times?
How's it go?
Can we play a little bit of that, Josh?
Oh, won't you stay with me? 'Cause you're all I need. This ain't
never heard that song.
Really?
No, no. If they don't play it on the 80s station, I don't hear it.
It's a massive hit in this time.
Oh, really?
In the present day. Yes.
My bad.
Get in the time machine, Marty, and come join us. But if you listen to it enough and carefully enough, it sounds very familiar. It did to me
earlier. It does. It does a little bit. There's something about it that's like, yeah, fucking holy shit, man. It sounds like.
Did it maybe sound like this to you?
Yes!
Back down. Oh, won't you stay with me?
Back down.
Nana. All back down. You can stay with me up at the gates of hell, but I won't back down.
Oh my God, he stole it.
Yeah.
You know, wow, we were like two detectives, man. They need a fucking show about us, the singing detectives, and then the fucking third act, we crack the crime by singing along and shit. Glee is ending.
Smith and Garmin, music detective.
Yes.
Instead of badges, we have like big 45s.
And when we arrest kids, they're like, what is that?
Yeah. All right, hold on, I got a CD in this pocket. There we go.
And the what kids is that? Like,
what is that? Yeah. We're not the only ones who thought that sounded familiar. Tom Petty's lawyers also thought it sounded very familiar.
Oh, fuck. Did he go after him?
Yeah. They contacted Sam Smith and said, hey, you know that song that sounds just like fucking Don't Back Down by Tom Petty? Yeah. You're going to have to write us a check.
Really?
To his credit, Sam Smith did not say, let's not go to court, whatever. You're right. I can hear it. My bad. And he gave not only Tom Petty, but Jeff Lynne from ELO, the guy he did Traveling Wilburys with and all those other songs, they co-wrote that song together. They each now get 12.5% writing credit on Stay With Me in perpetuity.
Holy shit,
so that's
man.
A big, that's fucking, nice residual
for
them.
But it's just awesome. It's awesome of the dude to be like, yeah, done and done, my bad.
He's like, you know what? You got me. It's a fair cop. Here's your money. Now, he claims he didn't do it consciously.
I was going to say, I bet you he didn't, too. I mean, there's only so many different ways you can bend a note and whatnot, and I'm sure he was just like, oh, this fucking rocks.
This sounds great.
Without thinking about, like, oh, it sounds like something
and
else.
And Tom Petty himself said, I'm sure it was just an accident. But he didn't turn down the money. So.
I'm sure it's an accident, but I'm sure I'll be spending my 12.5%.
The song's already sold more than 4 million copies all over the world. So for songwriting residuals, they're already getting a big check written.
It's very
for
good,
them,
but they're not playing it on the 80s station.
No,
so it can't
they're
be
not.
That good.
I'm sorry. Hey, you know how it must be another day? Because the sun comes up and another woman says Bill Cosby raped her.
We were having such a good time.
I know. Look, we got to tell both the good and the bad stories.
Oh, man.
Another alleged victim of Bill Cosby came forward this week. Her name is Syndra Ladd. She is a former entertainment executive. She is the wife of a Hollywood producer named Alan Ladd Jr.
Holy fuck.
Yeah. She's a legit, like, person. This is not...
They're all legit people,
I know,
man.
I know. Don't get me wrong. Obviously,
listen
they're all
legit people.
Listen
to the judge here. Some of these are not legit.
No, you know what I mean. Some of these women have been... the aspersions have been cast on them because they're models or actresses or whatever, and people look down at them. But this woman is a high-class entertainment executive. She's got nothing to gain by coming forward and talking about this.
Right.
No publicity value is going to help her career. This is strictly a woman coming forward and telling her story because she believes it's the right thing to do.
Okay.
She says in 1969, she was 21 years old. Bill Cosby was 32. They got together. She had a headache. He gave her a pill. We all know the story by now. It's been told over and over again. Next thing, she woke up in his bed the next morning naked. She said he was walking around the room in a white terry cloth bathrobe, acting as if there was nothing unusual. It was obvious to me that he had had sex with me. I was horrified, embarrassed, and ashamed, she said. So.
Hey. I'm going to hell now.
Come on, man. How many more have to fucking come out before somebody does something? I mean, there's one.
What can we do, though?
Wasn't there one, fairly recent one, about the Playboy Mansion? They said she was within the...
She had talked to the LAPD, and they are apparently investigating because she's still within the statute of limitations for assault.
Can we go back to talking about something funny?
Sure. Lindsay Lohan's in the news this week.
Lindsay Lohan. Why don't you come to your senses?
This is a great story. Lindsay Lohan is a major fuck-up. We all know that. And
But, to her credit, has never raped anybody.
That's true. That we know of. So she rear-ended an 18-wheeler on the freeway a couple years ago. Like you do.
I take back what I said, apparently.
She raped a truck with her Beamer. And so she had to do 240 hours of community service as part of her probation.
What does that mean? Do they, like, pick up garbage on the highway?
Well, you can do it any number of ways. Partially, she did part of it at the morgue, famously. She was down there at the morgue cleaning up and stuff at the L.A. County morgue.
Oh, I remember that, man.
And there is that. You can do roadside pickup.
I said that, like, I remember that because I was there, too.
Yeah.
But I remember we talked about it on
talk
the show.
About
yeah. I don't hang out at the morgue.
There's a lot of ways that you can do it, but you have to do it. That's the only thing the court really demands of you is that you fulfill your obligations to the courts. She has been not on top of this thing, according to the court. So her lawyer Wednesday went into the court and said she's done amazing strides towards completing this, Your Honor. She pulled off 80 hours in just 9 days. She did another 80 hours. And the city attorney said, what did she do? And she said, well, in London, she did a play in London. After the play, she did a meet and greet with a lot of fans.
That does not fucking count as community service, does it?
The judge said, that does not fucking count as community service. So now they've launched an investigation into the meet and greet to see if it in any way could possibly qualify as community service, which we know, obviously, just by the smell test that it doesn't. I will be meeting people out in the bar after the show because I got busted, so I need to fucking get some community service. So.
Where was the accident?
It was on the 101 here in Los Angeles.
Why would it matter if she fucking met meet and greet people in London?
Well, because she moved to London to work, they allowed her to establish residency there and complete some of her obligation there as well. If she did community service in London, it would count towards her probation here in California.
So in London, she may be walking around the side of the road picking up garbage?
Well, she isn't. She's going, hi, I'm Lindsay Lohan. Can I blow you? Or whatever she does after a show.
That was the dude from Sydney who was like, fuck her.
Yeah.
Perth, my bad. And he's getting hostile and drunk, yes.
Close
Perth,
your cunt.
Perth.
Speaking of Lindsay, she has announced this week that she's looking into becoming a witch.
Like a Wiccan?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. She said she would like to control her own destiny, do spells, make potions, and read cards.
Oh, she's definitely going to be in Slytherin House. I'll tell you that right now. You don't need a sorting hat to figure that fucking shit out.
She got the idea because she needed a job, and she asked someone to cast a spell for it, and she ended up doing that play in London. So it must be real.
Oh, my God. Are you kidding me? She buys that now?
Yeah.
So she could make, like, deals with the devil and shit.
She wants to be a white witch, Kevin. They don't deal with the devil. She's like Sabrina. She's got a cat that talks to her and a couple nice aunts, and she lives in a very nice middle-class neighborhood.
That's your definition of a white... I mean, I guess that's a pretty fucking white witch.
You can't get any whiter than Melissa Joan Hart, whatever her fucking name was. Her name was Melissa Joan Hart, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. I'm really smart tonight. It's that time of year again, the promposals. You familiar with promposals? This has become a thing now, where people go on the internet and embarrass themselves and beg celebrities to go to proms with them. I would like to ask teenagers, any teenagers who are listening to the show, fucking cut it out.
Because
it's embarrassing to everyone.
No, it's fun. They shoot the moon every once in a while. Some celebrity's like, all right, I'll do it.
Yeah, but there's a person in your fucking class. There's a girl with glasses, or there's somebody with braces, or there's a person who maybe is a couple pounds overweight who would fucking love to go to the prom with you. Ask that fucking person.
Yeah. Yeah, ask me next time,
yeah,
would you?
Kevin, he'll go with you. Don't ask Selena Gomez like this tool did. A guy named Cole LeBrant. Cole LeBrant. What kind of fucking name is that? Cole LeBrant.
That is kind of, if you're going to imagine a name for a dude who's bold enough to be like, I want to go to the prom with Selena Gomez, Cole LeBrant is your man.
Cole LeBrant.
That's a TV detective. I think he was one.
He's a music detective?
Yes.
Does he work on our squad?
Yeah. No, he's after our show.
Oh, man. Okay.
It goes the singing detective and then Cole LeBrant.
He is a senior in Enterprise, Alabama. And he has got a video now that's getting a lot of attention online for Selena Gomez to go to the prom with him. And he lip syncs to all her songs and he does all these dance moves.
Like the fucking dude in Silence of the Lambs? Yeah, that'll make me want to go to the prom. He's like, goodbye, horses. With his dick fucking tucked. Selena goes, like, I wonder if I should go. It is Alabama.
Here's a little clip of Cole LeBrant and his plea to Selena Gomez.
There's a million reasons why.
No. Actually, there's only one reason why you should go to prom with me. My name's Cole LeBrant. I live in Enterprise, Alabama, and not much exciting stuff goes on here. But if you were to go to prom with me, it would be something that I would never forget, and I would try to make sure that you had a really good time too. So, Selena Gomez, will you go to prom with me?
What do you think that last part means? Like, I would try to make sure you had a good time too. That's code for I eat pussy. Which apparently is very rare in Alabama.
If the state of Alabama would just let Cole take his boyfriend to the prom, we wouldn't have anything. We have none of this to deal with. That's how I feel. If they would just get out of the dark ages and let Cole take his boyfriend, we could all just put this to rest.
It's true. It seems like a safe choice.
Hi, Selena. Yes. I've got a rose for you, and I'd really like you to go to the prom with me. And I do all your songs and all your dances, too. Would you like to see them? I'm Cole LeBrant. Jazz hands.
Fucking Cole LeBrant. You are now my enemy, Cole LeBrant, wherever you are.
Not mine. Keep reaching for the stars, Cole LeBrant. Literally reaching for them.
Hey, fuck tape star Kim Kardashian's in the news this week.
Kim Kardashian, Kim Kardashian, who gives a fuck?
Super Bowl is coming up this weekend. Super Bowl.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Super Bowl's not on the 80s
channel. Not at all,
either.
No.
Super Bowl's coming up. A lot of people care more about the commercials than they do the actual game itself. And sadly, Kim Kardashian has herself a Super Bowl ad that everyone's talking about this week. It's for T-Mobile, and it's a parody of her pseudo-famous celebrity status and all the selfies that she puts online and stuff. It has to do with data and shit. And it frustrates me. Yeah, her oily ass is not in the commercial, which is the only reason you would use her in a commercial, is to park a bike in between those giant ass cheeks.
Yeah.
But what frustrates me about this, and it does about the Justin Bieber getting a roast too, is like, I don't want these fuckers to be in on the joke when we mock them. They don't get to have it both ways. They don't get to be obnoxious fucking douchebag celebrities and then get also to be on the inside mocking themselves too. No,
yeah.
Sir.
Yeah, they do.
Oh, that's true. Here's the commercial. Here's 30 seconds of Kim Kardashian doing just that.
Hi, I'm Kim. Each month, millions of gigs of unused data are taken back by wireless companies. Tragic. Data you paid for that could be used to see my makeup, my backhand, my outfits, my vacations, and my outfits. Sadly, all lost. Please, help save the data.
She looks like whenever they show you in a...
You're goddamn right.
Whenever they show you a picture online of like, this is a human being or like a robot, and they have this thing called the uncanny valley where the human eye looks at something, and if it's not right, if it's not organic and natural, your brain knows it. Even if it's close, it's like looking at an android or the fucking Hall of the Presidents when they stand up.
You're or
like,
CGI sometimes.
Or CGI. Imagine. She has now crossed into that place where she just doesn't even look like a human being anymore.
Right. She's a replicant.
Yeah, totally. Fucking, she's fucking Rachel in Blade Runner.
Right,
man.
Yes, she is. Decker, no. her stepfather, Bruce Jenner, is also in the news this week because apparently now we're all going to find out what the fuck's going on with Bruce Jenner. The story for a long time had been everyone thought they were kind of whispering, I think he's making a transition from a man to a woman. Well, it came out this week that Bruce Jenner is making the transition, but the reason we haven't heard anything about it is because nothing happens in that family unless there's cameras rolling. So he is shooting a series, a TV series, that will document his change from man to woman.
So that's for real, then?
That's for
he's
real.
He's really doing that?
It's going to be on E! Because their entire life is on E! And it's going to be Bruce Jenner, his journey from Wang to No Wang. I think that's what it's called. Bruce Jenner, Wang to No Wang. It's called Jenner, I Hardly Even Know Her.
Wow, man. In our childhood, this was the dude on the Wheaties box.
He was the greatest athlete of all time.
The decathlon.
In the 1970s, yes. And now he is going to be the greatest female athlete, I guess, of all time. He's going through with the process. They are documenting it. Little by little, he is changing over. We've seen the nails and the hair and the shaving of the Adam's apple. This week, he had his lips done, because that's a family tradition with the Kardashians, to have your lips bloated. Here's a picture of Bruce after he had his lips plumped up.
Right on. I mean, good for him, man. I guess he's felt trapped all this time. Now he gets to be who he feels like he really is.
Yeah, look, if I was married to Kris Jenner, I'd fucking take my wang off, too. You know what I'm saying? See what you did to me? Look what you fucking did to me. While we're talking about body parts, Taylor Swift this week. I'm sorry, Tadoff Switler. She put the end of a mystery that's been plaguing us for her entire career. Does she have a belly button?
This has been a thing? Like nobody's seen her belly button?
She has never shown her belly button in public.
She like fucking Kyle XY or something?
That's right. The first Kyle XY reference of the 21st century, ladies and gentlemen. Well done, Kevin Smith.
Nobody's seen her belly button?
Every time she wears a bathing suit, she wears one of those old-timey 1950s bathing suits that kind of comes up to her ribs. Well, this week, very exciting news, there was a photo of her that she put up on her Instagram showing her belly button. Would you like to see it?
Yeah, well, especially if there's a fucking songwriting troll that lives in it, yes.
Like Quato?
Yeah.
This would be the part where we look at the picture of Taylor Swift. There we go. There it is right there, ladies and gentlemen. She does indeed have a belly button.
She got a blank space. I could imagine a little alien coming out of there and being like,
too.
Here are lyrics to a song.
Here's what she said to a magazine regarding her belly button. This is a fucking news story.
And we're doing it.
That's right. I don't like showing my belly button. When you start showing your belly button, then you're really committing to the midriff thing. I only partially commit to the midriff thing. You're only seeing my lower rib cage. I don't want people to know if I have one or not. I want that to be a mystery. What the serious fuck?
I mean, fucking, like, the mystery is more intriguing if it's like, I wonder if she has a dick.
Right.
Maybe that's why she doesn't want to see a mannish belly button. We'll figure out she's got a dick.
Unless she was raised in a lab, grafted off the back of a shaved mouse or something. We know she has a belly button. She has parents, right?
Or if she was born this fucking succubus.
Good point.
A child of the beast, there would be no belly button.
You're absolutely right.
Because the devil's baby shoots out the ass, you see.
You know way too much about Satan. Speaking of Tadoff Switler, she also trademarked some things this week. She's already trademarked her name, Taylor Swift, and the initials TS, by the way. Boy, is Tom Selleck pissed. And this week, she trademarked some phrases off her latest album, 1989. So no longer can use any of these phrases without paying her a substantial royalty. Well, first of all, you know, this is from her unbelievably annoying song, Shake It Off. Remember this part in the middle where she's sort of rapping in the center of it? This sick beat has now been trademarked by Taylor Swift.
So what, if I ever put those three words together, I owe money?
Ching.
The fuck out of here.
People have been talking about sick beats for as long as there have been sick beats.
Yeah.
Now she owns it. She also owns Party Like It's 1989. Oh, Prince is not going to be happy. I was off by 10 years. Cause We Never Go Out of Style, Could Show You Incredible Things, and Nice to Meet You, Where You Been?
Oh, that's some Nice to Meet You, Where You Been.
Oh, that fucking song, you know. That's not on the 80s channel either, by the way.
My kid.
Oh, yeah. Like, oh, sure, blame her.
When that album came out, my kid was like, you got to listen to one of these songs. And she played me that song. At the end of it, I was like, oh, it's actually kind of catchy. I didn't buy the album or anything, but I was like, all right. But that's the first time I've ever heard that song or seen that video and shit. She's very energetic in that.
You don't know Shake It Off?
Not at all.
You're like a special project.
Yeah. It's possible to avoid this shit in the real world, man.
I want to be you for a couple minutes. These trademarks cover anything that you would use those phrases on, from clothing to accessories to kitchenware and, I'm not kidding, this is in the contract, non-medicated toiletries.
So ass wipes?
Yes. You can have the Shake It Off ass wipes.
Or the Taylor Swift ass wipe, which is redundant.
That's right.
All right, I will file that.
Speaking of ass wipes, congratulations to Tila Tequila. She won Best Celebrity Sex Tape at the AVN Awards last weekend. For those of you who don't know, that's the Adult Video News Awards. It's porn's Oscars. Just ask them. Tila Tequila 2, Backdoored and Squirting, won for Best Celebrity Sex Tape.
I wish they wouldn't be so subtle with the titles.
Me too. I have no idea what the plot of this movie is.
Yeah. Make it simple, like Star Wars, so we know what's going on.
Exactly. But Backdoored and Squirting? Well, how do I know whether I want to buy that or not?
That title, it reminds me of The Unbearable Lightness of Being. What
Could
is that
be
about?
Anything.
Yeah.
You know, he's very upset, Farrah Abraham. She won't. She was in Vegas. She was hoping to win Best Celebrity Sex Tape as well with her backdoor teen mom. But she had...
Yeah. Who was that?
That was the Australian.
That was you?
Yeah.
Perth?
Yeah. She had to settle for the rollout of her new sex toy, and it's really impressive. This is the Farrah Abraham blow-up doll. We have a shot of it. This is the actual thing right here. Wow. It's so lifelike.
Oh, my God. Look, man, I've put my dick a number of weird places, but never something like that.
No. But I would spend an hour with that doll before I'd spend 5 minutes with her. Just a conversation. Just on a date.
Totally.
In movie news, it's finalized. The female reboot of Ghostbusters has been announced this week.
Right on, man. Now, here's fucking crazy? We're getting another Ghostbusters, man. Everyone's like, boo.
But here's the thing is, do we need another Ghostbusters?
Sure, why the fuck not?
Because here's why I say not. And the last time we talked about this, I got into trouble with some women who thought I was poo-pooing female comedians, and I'm not at all. But here's my take on this completely. Ghostbusters is a dead franchise, by all accounts. No one can bring it back. Bill Murray doesn't want to do it. It's over. It's finished. There's the four ladies they want to put in a new Ghostbusters. Kristen Wiig, Melissa McCarthy, Kate McKinnon, and Leslie Jones from Saturday Night Live. That's a great female comic cast. Why not give them a brand new movie that is them doing what they do best without having to carry the baggage of Ghostbusters around? Like Bridesmaids was a great female comedy that did a lot to advance, I think, the cause of putting women in leads in comedies.
Yes.
Why wouldn't you write them a fresh, funny franchise of their own rather than trying to bring that Ghostbusters franchise back to life?
Because it's not called show integrity, Ralph. It's called show business. And these motherfuckers are like, oh my God, Ghostbusters with an all fucking female cast? Any Ghostbusters alone was probably going to make a bunch of money. But you put it in those fucking people who are very funny, very talented, and they know they're just going to print money all the way to the bank. And that's what it is. No studio executive is sitting at Sony going like, man, we got to preserve the fucking integrity of boy Ghostbusters. They're sitting in an office going like, I need to fucking figure out how to keep this job, and I think putting a bunch of ladies in a new Ghostbusters movie is the way to do it.
I don't care about preserving the integrity of boy Ghostbusters. I don't care about that franchise. What I care about is women advancing in comedy, and Bridesmaids prove that an original script that's not based on an old franchise can make a ton of cash.
Absolutely. The reward for that is they're like, well done, here's fucking Ghostbusters, man. Yeah. Like, They've earned it. Like, give it to them. And again, it's like, I don't give a fuck who's in it, man. It's another Ghostbusters.
What about an all-dwarf Ghostbusters?
I'm in.
All right.
Oh, my God.
That would be kind of cool.
I would watch an all-Bruce Willis Ghostbusters.
Well, now you're just being disgusting.
No, I'm just a big fan of the franchise. A good idea.
Here's the photo that Paul Feig, the director, tweeted out on social media this week. So that's what it's going to look like, only with less hairy arms, I'm guessing. But now you have an idea.
They are all funny, though.
They are all very funny. Kristen Wiig, by the way, is a friend of mine because...
What? Really?
Yeah. Kristen and I are friends.
How long? What the fuck? When did this happen?
This happened like 15 years ago.
Where'd you meet her?
We both got our first big break on television in the same show, a show called The Joe Schmo Show.
She was on that show as well?
The very first Joe Schmo Show, but way before SNL. She was still in the Groundlings. And I was the host of this faux reality show called The Joe Schmo Show, and she played a character on that show called Dr. Pat. And she was pretending to be a reality show contestant along with a half a dozen or so other very funny improv actors. And we had one real guy in the mix who didn't know that the whole thing was a put-on. But she was one of those people, when you're working with her, everybody was looking at each other saying, if she isn't a huge star in the next 5 years, she should be, because everyone knew she was the funniest person on the set by far. So it's so cool to watch her just become a superstar, you know?
Do you still talk to her?
Not all the time, but, like, you know, when we run across each other, it's always very warm and friendly.
I think she's fucking crazy funny. Man.
I will do that.
Like the SNL thing with little baby hands?
Yeah, how great is that?
That is fucked, and that's
And you
so
know what?
Brilliant.
This Kate McKinnon, I don't know if you watch SNL
yeah,
at all.
Yeah, she's on now. She does Justin Bieber.
She's fucking she's genius she's awesome. As well. She's I have a huge crush on her, and I know she's a lesbian, but I don't care.
Is she really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. And she's playing Justin Bieber, so it's pretty accurate.
Exactly, yes. Speaking of reboots, let's get your take on this one. Disney owns Indiana Jones now. They bought
fucking
it
do it, yes. Do it and put Chris Pratt in it.
That's who they're talking about.
Yes! That's a huge win for everybody.
The table is not your wife. Stop beating it.
Sir, you know my wife. The beating goes the
That's
other
true.
Way.
That's true. I don't know what I was thinking.
Please.
Table? The Kevin is not...
This is the moment I saw Guardians of the Galaxy. I was like, holy fuck, he could totally be Indiana Jones. Yeah. I'm so glad they're thinking that.
Here's my take on though. Don't reboot it. Don't start from scratch. Just carry on as if it like James Bond. Just go on with another adventure and don't address the previous ones and just move forward.
Because they can literally do like, you know, the heyday of Indiana Jones. What was it?
1930s, late 30s.
So they could do
fight the Nazis again and just keep going. But let's make it, you know, a continuation. Like the Bond films never really addressed the previous, you know, films. They always just kind of move forward. I think that's what they should do with this character.
I'm all for it. But he's so fucking good. I like that guy.
He's terrific. From movies that we are debating on to movies that we know will suck.
Bruckheimer, Schumacher, Michael Bay. They make movies that make you say, oh my god, that's bullshit, what the fuck? They're movies that will suck.
As if the Transformers weren't bad enough. I think we have a Transformer. Apparently, they have just renewed the trademark on another franchise of toys that turn into robots and shit called the GoBots. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
You don't
really?
Need a GoBots movie. Nobody needs a GoBots movie.
I didn't think we needed a Transformers movie, but I was always wondering about it. If Transformers made so much money, I thought the GoBots were sitting there going, why not us?
Yes. For those of you who don't remember the GoBots, they were a knockoff of the Transformers back in the day. It was the Guardians against the Renegades. Leader One was the leader of the Guardians. That's how fucking low rent this franchise was. What should we call the leader? Leader? That's stupid. Leader One? All right, cool. And the Renegades were led by Psykill.
Oh, that's actually clever. Not clever enough for another franchise, a movie or something, but for a cartoon, that's cute.
Psykill, he turned into, what do you think? What are you guessing?
Motorcycle.
Motorcycle, yeah, well done, yeah. You're a GoBots fan, I can tell right here.
I just guessed, but he's like, I had the toys.
Yeah, so. I had Psykill. Fuck, Psykill fucking rocked.
For those of you who don't remember the GoBots or the 80s, here's the opening intro to their cartoon series. Even the song was low rent. Transformers. Transformers, more than meets the eye. Transformers, robots in disguise. The GoBots. The GoBots. The GoBots. Shut up!
What's it called again?
The GoBots. So now we're going to get a fucking GoBots franchise.
I think you should take that fucking music and make it your theme song.
Ralph Garman.
And then turn into something.
A professional?
You are kind of like, no, dude. You're kind of like your own version of a Transformer because you're one thing, and then you're like, ooh-ah, I'm fucking Al Pacino. Or ooh-ah.
Yeah, hello, everybody.
You are a human Transformer.
I think we have a GoBot. Can't wait for Mark to star in that. And lastly, Justin Bieber in the news this week.
Justin Bieber. Nobody fucking needs ya. You wanna know why? I'll tell you why. 'Cause you're a little cunt.
That's right, Bieber. You are a little cunt. Oh, no, I'm sorry. He's not a little cunt. Turns out we had him all wrong.
I knew it.
Yeah. No. I don't know if you saw the apology video this week or not. We had him all wrong. He's not that guy at all, Kevin.
He apologized?
Oh, yeah. He's
to who?
Sorry.
All of us?
To all of us. He had a very intense one-on-one conversation with you and him. He did the Ellen DeGeneres show this week. And afterwards, he got very sensitive and got on his Instagram or his Facebook, whatever the fuck. And he turned on his video camera and he poured his heart out. And he's sorry and he's not who we think he is. And I usually give you a snippet of something. We're going to sit back for a minute and 43 seconds and watch Justin Bieber apologize. Please enjoy.
I'm going to make a video because I wanted to express how I feel right now. So today, I was on Ellen. And it was a lot of fun. She's amazing. It was her birthday. Happy birthday, Ellen. But I was really nervous. And I think I was nervous because I was afraid of what people are thinking about me right now. It's been a minute since I've been on a public appearance. And I didn't want to come off arrogant or conceited. Or basically how I've been acting the past year and a half. I'm not who I was pretending to be. And why I say pretending is often we pretend to be something we're not as a cover-up of what we're truly feeling inside. And there was a lot of feelings going on in there. Just being young and growing up in this business is hard. It's growing up in general is hard. But yeah, I felt awkward up there. I felt like people were judging me. And I really want people to know how much I care about people, and how I'm not that person to say I don't give a fuck. You know, I'm not that kid. I'm the person who genuinely cares. And although what's happened in the past has happened, I just want to make the best impression on people and be kind and loving and gentle and soft. And although people can call me a softie, that's how my mom raised me. And
that's right, man.
Whoa.
He's a softie. He was pretending. He got his first period, this guy said. He's very emotional. He was not that guy. He was pretending, man. He was covering up for how soft and sensitive he is inside with that rough exterior, with that swag exterior.
Don't you wish they were like, in the video, of course, it looks very thin in the middle, as most videos do now, yes, with black on both sides.
Right.
You wish they would pull away the black bars and just see someone standing there with a rifle next to him or something like that.
You see ISIS next to him with a gun.
We'd apologize for all you have done.
So he cares about you. He's not that guy. You know, when he was leaning over the balcony of that hotel spitting on fans, he loves those people. When he was throwing the eggs in his neighbor's house, he loves that guy. He's a soft person. When he was pissing in the bucket, he was just pretending.
Sales must be down.
Yeah, I guess so. He's got to change a tact. He's got to come up with a new persona. Now he's sensitive Bieber.
I left the swag behind, yo.
Nothing more annoying than a fake apology. It's time for the geek news.
Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kev's geek news.
We're starting with this?
Well, yeah, we are.
Go ahead.
All right, I will. It's been much talked about the reboot of the Fantastic Four franchise by 20th Century Fox.
I thought this trailer looked fucking good, man. You didn't think so?
I think this trailer did nothing to get me want to see this movie any more than
really?
I wanted to.
Really? Oh, yeah. Not me. I saw the trailer. I was like, holy shit, there's a take on it. Like, I didn't think of that.
This is what they did with all the outtakes from all the X-Men movies. They cut them together into this trailer.
It's very serious. Yeah.
And it feels like the look is the same. It just feels like another thing.
I don't think it looks like the X-Men movies, to be honest with you, though. I think it has its own kind of, bless you, unique look. There's that video game, though, that they say it looks like. Particularly the one ending trailer sequence. I don't know what it's called. Somebody play video games? Interstellar? No, that's not a video game. Although it's as long as one.
Pac-Man?
Mass Effect.
Oh.
Something like that.
Frogger? I was going to say Frogger.
But I thought it looked good. I thought like they didn't do the typical like, my fucking parents are killed, everyone's going to pay, mask, cape, I'm a hero. It may look like a sci-fi movie. It does kind of look like Interstellar more than like a superhero movie.
It looks like Chronicle with a guy made out of rocks.
No, Chronicle looked like handheld and found footage. This doesn't look like that at all.
But I compare this to like an Avengers trailer, where it energizes you and say, I must go to this film when it comes out. I saw this, I said, I am not any more compelled to watch this movie in theaters than I was before I saw this trailer.
I'm the other guy. I had zero interest, and then I saw the trailer. I was like, holy shit, look at that. That's an interesting take on the Fantastic Four.
So you certainly went from zero to?
Interested, yeah.
Two?
To the number two?
Yeah.
No. I'm in.
You're three?
I'm going to see it. Four. Fantastic Four. I'm going to go see it, dude.
Well, here's the trailer, a little taste of the trailer from the Tweentastic Four. If you haven't seen it, here it is.
Did you call it Tweentastic?
Yes.
I want to see it.
All right.
It looks all right to me. Well, it seems like Marvel doesn't want it to happen, though, in a big, bad way.
Yeah. Like, they want that back.
They've cut the big time. They cut off the comic book. The Fantastic Four comic book is either come to an end or about to end.
Go fuck it up when you're done. Give it back to us, yeah, and we'll start fresh.
And the weird thing is they don't even need it. They're like, guess what? We can take Guardians of the Galaxy and turn that into something fucking huge.
Yeah,
so,
right.
Until they get.
But
the
I have a warm feeling for those characters. I mean, we all grew up with the Fantastic Four. I'd like to see them done right, and I still think they haven't got their just desserts yet.
No, but who knows? I think that movie looks good.
X-Men. Speaking of the X-Men, Fox is talking about turning it into a TV series for the network of Fox.
Is that,
we don't
I guess
need that.
That
we
would
don't
allow
need that,
them
right?
to keep the.
They just want to keep the franchise.
The franchise
they just want to keep
gone.
The characters. I don't need to see a TV series with the X-Men. They're making X-Men Apocalypse the next feature film and everything. That's fine, but I don't need a TV series.
I agree, but still at the same time, I'm all for as many comic book anything as possible. There was a time where we didn't have that.
Right.
And now it's like you can watch Gotham or Flash or Arrow. I don't, but you could.
See, that's my point. You don't even watch those
but
shows.
I know, but there's an opportunity to do it. And one day when I'm ready, I can catch up with them.
When you're ready. When it's on the 80s channel,
yes.
You'll be watching all of them.
Yes. When Martha Quinn is talking about it, I will be there.
Speaking of TV properties, CBS is doing Supergirl. They just announced that Melissa Benoist of Glee is going to be their Supergirl. She is not blonde, which kind of hurt me because I like my Supergirl blonde, but what do I know? I'm old guard. There's a whole new world out there. It doesn't care what color her hair is, I'm sure. They just announced they've got a Jimmy Olsen that's going to join the cast, and here is Mikad Brooks. He is playing Jimmy Olsen. It's uncanny. He looks just like him. Mikad, if you hadn't noticed, is an African-American actor, and it's a brand new take on Jimmy Olsen, which I think is kind of cool.
They almost did it in the Tim Burton take on Superman. When Tim Burton was going to direct the movie, Chris Rock was cast as Jimmy Olsen. We were shooting Dogma at the time, and he came in, and he was just like, guess who just got cast as Jimmy Olsen? I was like, you? He's like, why not me? I was like, no, I was just
like, no, absolutely.
So, yeah, that idea has been around since 98 to go in a different direction with Jimmy Olsen. Nice to see they finally did it.
There's a feature film in the works. Julia Roberts has bought the rights to Batkid. Remember Batkid? He is a 5-year-old boy who has leukemia, and he wanted to be Batman for a day in San Francisco. So the entire city rallied around him, and 25,000 people participated and turned San Francisco into Gotham City for the day.
He got to capture the Riddler
and the Penguin and a couple other adventures. He traveled with Batman and Batkid saved the day.
They turned it into a documentary, I believe.
They did, called Batkid. Miles Scott is his name. Now, Julia Roberts has bought the rights, and she will produce and star in a feature film, a fictional film, based on his story. She has announced she will play the 5-year-old boy with leukemia.
She's an amazing
actress. She can
actress.
Do it, man.
Yeah,
I think she's got range. She absolutely could do
Holy
it.
Holy shit.
And man. That vein in her forehead will come in very handy for treatment scenes. What the fuck?
You're against this?
Yes.
Why?
Because you can't tell this story any better than it's already been told.
I agree.
A fictionalized version of the story is going to be nearly as compelling as the real thing that we all saw played out in front of us.
I agree, but again... In a world where they're going to make a movie about something, like it's subject matter we like.
I know, and it's uplifting, and I get all that, but some 5-year-old Hollywood kid was going to play Miles, and he's not going to be nearly as compelling as the real thing. And we all saw it. It's not a little-known story that we missed out on. We saw the real Bat Kid.
True.
Fuck Julia Roberts. I'm just anti everything. You're just pro everything tonight.
One would think you had a fight with your wife before coming here. I'm fucking everything.
No, I had a fight with Julia Roberts before I came here. That was the problem. And let's give Batkid a Batmobile phone case. Have you seen this thing for $50 that you can own? It protects your iPhone 6. You have an iPhone 6?
Yeah.
You can now protect your iPhone 6 with the bulkiest phone case in the history of telecommunications. It is a Batmobile from the Burton Batman movies.
The fuck out of here, the real Batmobile?
Well, it's not a full-size Batmobile that you put your phone in, for fuck's sake.
That is my Batmobile, though. When I think of the Batmobile, it's the Tim Burton.
I'm the 66
one.
Batmobile, you're the 89 Batmobile.
Yeah, yeah.
But now they have a version of it that becomes a cell phone case for you to put your phone into.
I want it.
Here's a little video commercial for the new Batmobile phone case.
Wow, man.
You throw that picture up, Josh, it shows a little better of the details. That's the most fucking useless phone case in the history of mankind. Where are you going to put that, that you can carry that phone with you anywhere?
And that's the thing. It's like when you always have your phone on you, and people are like, he loves the Batmobile, because you're always carrying it around a giant
like a douchebag. You look like a special needs kid in class just playing with a car at all times. You're the McDonald's fry girl of cell phones.
Yeah, definitely you want to play with my Batmobile. Yeah, please pull around.
It's fucking $50 it's going to cost you. It's useless.
But you got to admit, it's kind of... admit that it's cool that it exists, man.
You are Hope Springs Eternal, guys.
I really am.
You are. I'm going to send you home to your wife, a much happier guy.
You show me. I came here and I was like, man, I just want to be Calgon, take me away. And you took me to a world where fucking the Batmobile could be a cell phone cover.
Yeah.
So thank
and
you.
The one cool thing about that is it does have LED lights. The back lights and the front lights light up. And then there's a projector in the back where the flame comes out of the back that shoots the bat signal up on a wall. It's like a projector. It does show that.
You were just shitting on it, man.
I'm giving you that. I'm giving you that one aspect
you
of it.
You fucking like showman piece of shit. You're like, look at how bad this is. Meanwhile, the alley afterwards,
cool
you're going to be
thing.
Like, look, I already bought one. Biggest Batman fan in the fucking world, man. You're like, it does have an afterburner.
All right, don't get one for yourself, because I'm going to get you one.
You better now, man.
For Valentine's Day.
Ooh. You will get anal. You hear that, newlyweds?
Yeah.
That's how it works.
That's how it's done. Every week, we like to close out the show by looking at the enormous penis of actor Liam Neeson.
Can't help but wonder how big is Liam Neeson's cock?
Wie groß ist im Liam Neeson's penis?
There we go. You can write us about anything here at the show at hbopodcast@aol.com. Or if you want to add to the legend that is Liam Neeson's cock, you can go to neesoncock.com and add your own facts about it. Here's this week's
facts. Do you think when Al Gore created the internet, do you think he ever thought that would be an address?
I think that's why he created the internet.
I like Liam Neeson's cock.
Is that your Al Gore?
It is, yeah.
Don't bring him to We Are the World, I'll tell you that right now.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Scientists believe he recently had an ejaculation in Wales. Can we see the photographic evidence and see why they think that?
Well, oh, yeah. Well, there's that cloud that appeared over Wales this week, I guess.
Shooting dust.
Shooting blanks, yeah. Liam Neeson's cock is so big. Tom Petty owes him money. Last week, we got a lot of attention, a lot of emails, a lot of people complaining, both complaining and celebrating the vajankle. We talked about the vajankle last week.
Oh, the fuckable foot? Yeah.
The fuckable foot. Can we throw up the vajankle for those who didn't catch last week's episode?
For anyone who ever fucking fantasized about fucking a foot.
It's a sex toy for people with foot fetishes.
I would rather fuck that brony doll than that.
I'd fuck the Pharaoh Abraham blow-up doll before
yeah,
I'd fuck that.
Yes.
That's important information to have for this next fact. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
He can't use a vajankle. He has to use a vatorso. The first person who sends in a picture of the vatorso, I will send a special prize to.
That's a long way to go for that joke, but it was worth it.
I thought
yeah,
so.
Well done.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Gandalf lets it pass.
None shall pass. All right, you.
Come on. And lastly, Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Bill Belichick filmed it. Tom Brady deflated it, but the Patriots still can't beat it. There you go.
Ladies and gentlemen,
that's a football joke.
Okay, I figured yes, I was lost. Ladies and gentlemen, Hollywood, have you had a good time this evening?
Thank you, as always, for joining us tonight. This means nothing without you guys.
And this show would not exist without our Babble host. Give it up for Mr. Ralph fucking Garman.
Let's hear it from my good friend and Babble brother, Mr. Kevin Smith.
And that is Hollywood Babylon for this week. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman.
Babble the fuck off. Good night.